Hello people, it is I again. Just doing another little video for you. This one is a good one. It's going to be quite in depth. It's in relation to a BBC documentary that's been published here online via some chap called Paul, who's apparently associated with it's like the Friends of the Hereditary Peerage. This is quite an interesting point in time because it's coming up again and again in more recent days about the constitutional changes that our good friend Tony Blair, former Prime Minister, who was elected in 1998 on his 1997 manifesto. And what we're going to do, we're going to just have a look at this because basically what this was is a big kicking out. So before you Americans start turning off and thinking, oh, I don't care about that British nonsense, do take heed because it does represent, the president in America is essentially your monarch, the king, the executive, right? A monarch, president, dictator, despot, whoever you want to call it, they're your executor, okay? And then you have underneath that in America, you have the Senate, which I believe is akin to our House of Lords. And then under that, you have your House of Congress. Now, Congress in America would be the equivalent to the English House of Commons, where people are elected and make the laws, apparently. Or at least they make statutes, they make amendments to public laws. So we're going to look at this. It's a very interesting point in time. Is that right? A place in time? There's a lot. So imagine you're a lord or a senate. You've been in the Senate, a senator all your life, your dad's dad, your dad's dad's dad, or your father, all the way going back to 12. 12 something, maybe, possibly. Your ancestors have sat in this house, which essentially they built, they commissioned, they designed, they paid for in many respects, in order to have service to the monarch. And that's where you have the no tax without representation. So you represent the king's interest, and for representing the king's interest, you get certain rights and guarantees given back to you, i.e., titles, lands, privileges. So this. Imagine 800 years of that history, potentially, for some of these people, all the way going back to Magna Carta and all that nonsense. And now you're in a position where Tony Blair, a little Labour, new Labour guy, gets voted in. And the best way I can describe new Labour to an American is think of half Democrat, half Republican. So, imagine like you're a popular Democratic movement, or should we say a fake conservative? There we are. So it'd be like a Democrat who's really leaning towards Republican ideals. Okay, so they get in under a popular vote, sick and tired of many, many years of Republican rule, which would be conservative rule in here in England. And then there's a big swing, and everyone's fed up with these people, and they want to get them out. And someone like Barack Obama comes along, and everyone goes crazy for this guy. So Tony Blair was very much, I hate to use this, call it the similar, comparing like chalk and cheese in such a way, but essentially Tony Blair did have a very successful election, and he came in and started implementing his manifesto under the guise of New Labour, New Britain. And I think the legacy of Tony Blair is that people realise he wasn't really a true socialist Labour kind of person. He was more of a halfway house between some socialist ideals and conservative Tory principles, but really just a force unto himself, really. He was his own party masquerading as the Labour Party, and this is why we have issues nowadays with Jeremy Corbyn being a very traditional Labourite, socialist Labour, for the people, of the people kind of mantra, having issues with the legacy of the new Labour people who all hate Jeremy Corbyn because he represents the old days, the dark ages, if you like, of British socialist policy, and all the struggles that that's causing. And now you have a Tory party that's trying to kind of rebuild itself, rebuild its image in the wake of the harsh defeat and the years of change that Tony Blair brought upon the way that government works. Just want to watch this little. So that's the context. Okay, so we're going to watch this documentary. It's really interesting. It's going to be long. I'm going to have to break this down into several parts because I don't think people's concentration lasts that long. But I'll start with part one. Should be about 20 minutes, and then I'll make the other parts as I can resource and reference them as I can. So there we go. So I just want to look at this. So this is a program. I believe it's made by the British BBC, the British Broadcasting Corporation, and just look at the first intro about, you know, think of us the people and them the lords, the nobility, yeah? Us the people, them the nobility, and see how this whole introduction is made and how it makes you feel, how it's, you know, the music playing, the you know, just absorb it all in, and hopefully you just will shake you to the core and realize that that is nothing to do with anything that a common man would ever have experience of or aspire to. It's quite, if in a way, like a different culture. It's like walking around, let's say, the streets of China. You're having a great time, but the food's all different, the language is different, everything just seems, you know, foreign. Just stop it there. Look, so here you are, you have this Gothic revival architecture, which is all based around the old palaces of Westminster and all the halls that preceded it, and obviously as it expanded. So yeah, in a normal city you have this institution dunked down right in the middle, which is a complete and utter, it's almost, you know, it's almost like a foreign body. Look at it, like the normal office buildings around it, you know, and then you've got this like Gothic architecture for a very specific purpose, to represent a very specific set of people in society. Here they are. Here's a poor common man who's serving on the building, hoisting up something, and what was in that little sack that he's hoisting up? The symbol of their society. Oh, glorious. Now let's look around the chambers. These are the chambers where these hereditary lords who created the House of Commons and the Parliament, and the Houses of House of Lords, sorry, and Parliament, with the monarch. So look at this. So clearly the monarch sits up there in the golden seat, and you have all these important hereditary peers and lords, as it used to be, who run the kingdom on, you know, help the king remain where he is and run the kingdom on his behalf. They would sit on the royal red levers all around, or the noble levers. And you'll see in the House of Commons, everyone sits on green lever. Green like the mud, the grass, the land, the people of the land. And these are the people of the royal blood, the bloodlines. So there we go. Yeah, but just look at this. I mean, the grandeur, the, I don't know if opulence is the right word, but, you know, just look at, holy moly. And this is a nice little touch. We're looking at all the shields, the heraldry of the barons, and you can tell a baron, I'll get my mouse out, so you can see the knight's helmet looks to the left, looks to the right, where the monarch quite often looks front on, because you do not stare at the monarch, you always avert your eyes in such a way. So this is a baron. The baron has a crown, the crown relates to the rank, so this is the monarch's crown, and the baron crown has just a few dots around it. So this is all heraldry that used, because, you know, some people couldn't read, essentially, so this would be like, you know, like the arms for a particular family, and you would recognize your families by the colors and the heraldry and the choice of what they put around it, flowers or the colors and sometimes the stripes and things like that. So that just harks back to the very people who instituted this house. It was the nobles. It's nothing to do with the people.
Bonus, Bragg, Brown Wilkinson, Buchan, Coke, Crick Howell.
Here on the red benches of the chamber of the House of Lords sit the peers of the realm. For the last 4 years, they've been the focus of a drama whose repercussions could affect us all.
Gavron, Glenask, Glenamara, Harmsworth, Harris of Peckham, Henley.
Some are lords appointed for their lifetime, but some are hereditary.
Some are lifetime, some are hereditary. Now, lifetime peers have become a very popular thing now because the House of Lords has got like 800 members, about 100 of which are hereditary, remaining from this banishment, I think, as it's referred to in this documentary. So all the people, there were something like 600, 700 people in here previously, all hereditary. mostly hereditary, and then they got rid of like so many of them, and they kept about 100, and now they've just filled it full of life peers. And a bit of hoo-ha's established about that is because a lot of people are buying their way, like the party donors, or there's been a lot of like who's actually getting into this House of Lords as it is now with a lifetime peer, so it's, you know, you don't carry it over to you, you know, when you die it doesn't pass to your next of kin, you just have it for your life peers. So yeah, how have people been getting these titles? Because this house pretty quickly got filled up, and a lot of the times politicians who were in Congress, for example, or the House of Commons, end up in here now for life.
The hereditaries are from families whose right to come to this place and contribute to the lawmaking process has been passed down the generations for hundreds of years.
And that's what she just said. You know, they've had the right to sit in their own house for hundreds of years, but obviously as parliaments evolved, this is now becoming annoying to the commons people, or the people who are running that house, if you like, the parliamentarians. You know, these old stuffy old gits who speak awfully posh and gone to the, you know, all learnt Latin at school and somehow know the laws and the culture of the realm, they're all getting in the way now. They're like the balance and checks of the commons, and the commons are basically like, especially with Tony Blair, are just like, well, they're all a bunch of conservatives. They don't represent our Labour socialist views, and we need to reform this. And on his manifesto, which we'll go into, where he mentions about this in some detail.
Many governments have considered the abolition of the hereditaries, but none has attempted it because they couldn't come up with a working alternative.
That's a good point. So think about it. If America, if the House of Congress in America, or the House of Commons in England, if they decided to vote out the Senate or the House of Lords, well, hang on a minute, then what? You almost become a despot, because in America, the president does have some executive powers. But in England, essentially, the monarch has executive powers in name only. She could fight against it if she so wished, or he so wished, depending on the king or queen. They could start stamping their foot down, start reneging on some of their contracts, saying this is unfair, this is all going wrong. But ultimately, all of their power to do any kind of day-to-day administration has been reined off by the crown, or turned off to the Houses of Parliament, to the people who get voted in.
This government felt more strongly.
So if a checks and balances of the commons is the Lords, the stuffy old Lords who say, oh, that's nonsense, that's too progressive, that's not in keeping with tradition and you know, our heritage, which is a good thing and a bad thing. So it keeps, you know, it keeps progress ticking over, but it makes sure that we're not going in a crazy direction. And of course, since they all got kicked out, like you kick out the whole Senate, then who's going to control how's the executive or the monarch going to control the Commons or the Congress? You know, if Congress has no checks and balances, or removes one of the antagonistic elements of the democracy, then it's just going to be able to run away with it. And that's the problem that they're basically always thinking. Well, if we get rid of the checks and balances side, who's going to checks and balance us? No one. That's a bit obvious. That's a bit obvious of a despotism brewing away. A despotism by an oligarchy, should I say?
People say there's no Tory opposition anymore.
Sorry, I interrupted Tony Blair. So listen to Tony Blair. This is just as he's got elected in.
Felt more strongly.
People say there's no Tory opposition anymore. Well, there is. It's alive and well and unelected and in the House of Lords with a 3-1 majority over it.
See, he's very much using his popular vote now to attack the House of Lords, as in the country's come out and voted Labour, we've got this great majority in Congress or Parliament, and we've got a problem, is that the Senate is full of, or the House of Lords is full of a bunch of conservative, you know, stiff upper lip toffs who we just don't get on with. They don't represent our ideals, and they're going to block everything that we do. Look at everyone just clapping like, yes Tony, we trust in you, Tony, and you're right to trust in him, but history is telling a different tale.
And when we used the mandate the British people gave us at the ballot box to get rid of the power of those hereditary peers, I call that democracy.
He calls it democracy, but it's more of a tool to despotism, really. Uninfringed decision-making. yeah, it's easy to point out these stuffy old gits are a bunch of, mothball closet antiquities that the realm no longer needs. But you, like I said before, you get rid of the checks and balances, it just paves the way to despotism. I'm all clapping their own. Yeah, let's get rid of checks and balances. We know what's best. Come on, Tony, lead us.
This promise was a popular one. It appealed to a party impatient to modernise.
Yeah, I suppose this is popularism. Everyone's going on about Trump being a popularist president. Look at Tony Blair. She just used the word there, populist. I suppose this is the birth of populist. Well, I wouldn't say it's the birth of it, but this is definitely a populist movement and the harm that it can do.
The country. The hereditaries would go. After all, few could justify their continuing presence. But that's as far as the plans went. Inside Parliament, controversy raged over who would take their place. And today, 3 years after their departure, the dilemma is still unresolved.
My lords, ladies and gentlemen, please rise for Lord Chancellor.
Was the removal of the hereditary peers in itself any guarantee of democracy?
Look at this picture. So you go through the doors into the House of Lords there, and what do you see? A whole golden wall with the throne. And this is where the monarch would sit. Going through a large room with a big, big, grandiose gate. What happens to that gate? Golden gate. Firmly shuts in front of you. And who would you almost like akin that to? St. Peter's Gate? St. Peter's Gate, mate, and you ain't coming in.
I wanted to tell the story of the end of the hereditary peerage in the House of Lords. The government wouldn't take part in the film and discouraged its party members from doing so too.
Oh, that's it. I didn't notice that before. She just said, so the government at the time, the Labour government, has asked that people don't get involved with this BBC documentary, this nosy reporter prodding her nose around and asking interesting questions and getting a feel of what's going on. What are people feeling? What do they actually really believe is happening?
So I focused on those who'd be banished. This is one side of the story, the hereditary side. After some 800 years, their time was up, and, many felt, not before time. As I started filming in October 99, it was clear, even to an outsider, that the house was unsettled.
You know, they all feel it. They feel like there's some sort of big shift, some great change, some what have I done to you, Tony? Why have I deserved this? All this history, all the, 800 years of history is now being finally a nail in the coffin. So you can imagine all these people, walking around, getting used to the old guys walking around these houses, and now they're all going to be cleared out with the new class.
The Reform Bill had been hanging over their heads for over a year, and the Lords had been doing their utmost to amend it.
Have you got a weekly report? Which I can say.
The government was now impatient for its business.
I am bound to say to the House that on this particular bill, I represent and lead for the government.
I represent and lead for the government. Now, this is Baroness Jay of Paddington, leader of the House of Lords, life peer, Labour. So she represents very strongly Tony Blair's interests in relation to getting through his reforms of the House of Lords. So it's a particular, it's dangerous where fashionable politics comes in and changes a whole 800 years of history. You know, like Trump comes in and anyone comes in and just on a wave of euphoria or populism. And changes, irrevocably changes, the status quo. And sometimes, the old ways are the best, sometimes the old ways are a bit rubbish. But at the end of the day, this is a big move. And what they had never really, it's like the Iraq invasion, the invasion of Iraq. They did, right, we're going to go and they're going to smash it up, we're going to solve the problem. But after they've won the battle, they didn't know how to win the peace, I think is probably a better way of saying it. So they went in, the might and the strength was amazing, but how did they secure and protect the Iraqi people and stabilise the country in order to have a successful future? That was obviously never a plan. So it's the same with the Lords. Let's go in with a wrecking ball, blow out all the old Lords. They're all peers, stuffy peers. They've got no democratic right to be there, apart from the fact that building's probably built by their ancestors' money or in the collections that they've made. And now they're saying, right, you guys, you've got to clear off. You're just the old world, we're the new world.
And the government feels very strongly, as do my backbenchers, on this matter, that we have wasted a great deal of time.
So you can see what she's highlighting here is the fact that the Lords, being the checks and balances to the Commons, have all the power under their ability to review laws that are coming out of Commons, that they say, you need to change this. No, you can change that. Hey, we want to get rid of you guys. No, you need to change this. Oh, come on, guys, we want to get rid of you. No, you need to change this. So you can see how it's kind of like banging your head against the wall over and over again. So it's just like, you know, this is what they're trying to... I like the way I pause it there, her little sneaky looking at the right side. I wonder what she's looking at. Oh, dear, I better unpause that before I give myself the willies. And that is your quintessential Lord right there. I don't give a tosh, little lady. Wah, wah, wah. Just close my eyes, go to sleep. But these people are some of the most educated, privileged people, and they know history, they know how it's gone for years, and they know, most importantly, how simple the law is and how the law in its simplicity relates to legislature. So this is how they can say, look, we can't do this, we can't do that, that's a bit wrong, this, that, and the other. So even though they're incredibly privileged and well off, they do, in a way, have a certain amount of moral fibre would be a good way of putting it.
An American commentator coined the phrase some time ago, clinging to the furniture. That's not a phrase much used in this country.
So imagine a life peer who's been placed there by some sort of appointment, coming into a hereditary peer's house and calling them a bunch of people who are clinging to the furniture, which is why that guy's looking at this lady, so excuse me, darling, you're clinging to my furniture. You're there, so you're standing up at my desk, at my table, and you're telling me I'm clinging to my furniture? This is how the House of Parliament originally was, you know, evolved from these Magna Carta and, you know, the peers and the barons creating the Parliament with inclusive of some of these people. But obviously the people that they included all those years ago, the tables have turned and it's become full. It's gone from the king having power, divine right of king being changed to the nobles having curtailed or limited the divine right of kings, and bringing in some of the important tradespeople and city states people and mayors and so much. So they brought them in on a very basic level. But essentially that was how it is. And now it's gone full tilt, where the monarch is being diminished to the point of, just what the point in having her? You know, why don't we just become some sort of republic in a way? That's what's happening now. And the old nobles that were like the core of the parliament have now almost, in a sense, taken the place of how the monarch is today. So the monarch's, in all of this, the monarch's getting squeezed. The right of the queen is getting squeezed and squeezed and squeezed. And the barons have now lost most of the barons, like something like 80% of the barons, possibly more, have now lost all their power in the House of Lords and Parliament, the House of Commons and Parliament. And now all these common folk, if you like, all these people who have interests all over the place, far and wide, and some quite possibly self-serving, are now going to be operating the House of Commons and elected or appointed to the House of Lords. And they're all going to have affiliated people who, you know, if you donate money to a party and they say, I'm going to make you a Lord in the House of Lords, then, you know, that's a free vote, essentially. It's going to be interesting. It's going to be, whereas just by birthright, you would turn up and say, all right, son, by the way, when you get to a certain age, you get to sit in this house and tell everyone how stupid they are. Whereas now it's like, well, if I go there, you're going to have to go in there and give something back. You know, hey, someone's going to put you there, someone's going to point you. There's going to be some sort of latch, some sort of condition.
But, my lords, there are some of us on this side of the house whose patience with some of these motions is becoming stretched.
I just want to highlight here the Father Christmas uniforms, okay? These are like baron. These are like your rankings. Okay, so two ranks is baron. So it would be an earl. Is it an earl? I think one is a baron, and that's basically, again, these are the clothes of their society. How their society recognises each other at a glance.
It was a case of out with the old and in with the new. As the hereditaries were leaving, the government was creating large numbers of new peers to redress the political imbalance in the house. But the house had never had such a rapid intake in its history.
So Tony Blair's filling the House of Lords with a load of his own lords, Labour lords and peers, yeah, life lords. So he's just filling that house full of his own people. This guy's great, I love him.
Have you felt differences? Have you felt a different attitude towards the House over the last few weeks?
Yes, I have.
Yes, I thought you might have.
I think people are rather indignant. But I think that's a pity. We must be nice to the new people who come. It isn't their fault that Tony likes them.
It's not their fault that Tony likes them. I think that's a brilliant thing to say.
Or is it?
Or is it? Comedian.
It's always been a very nice place there.
Thank you very much.
Now that is Lord Stockton with the beard.
Yes.
He's Macmillan's grandson.
Right. Yes.
And that was Glen Arthur.
The other man.
Yes. Yeah.
Where was your title from, Lord Romney?
So this is where he discusses his own title. It seems to be something of a controversy, because obviously there's always someone with a bigger title than you. Remember that. All these titles and all these like rankings, there's always a bigger fish, and the biggest fish of all is obviously the monarch. So all of these little shufflings and like, oh, so where do you stand on the ladder? Well, I stand just about here.
In the 18th century. And then we got made up at 18-1, we got made earls. But we were mere barons before that, you know. Riffraff.
You know, see how he jokes about it? You know, mere barons, the barons being the lowest rank of nobility. Riffraff, he calls them like the riffraff, almost like the peasantry, almost, you know, like common folk. Oh, just riffraff, barons. You know, and then he goes on to say, oh, we're actually made earls, which is a rank up. Let me see if I can bring up something I was looking at. I don't know if I still got it up. Is it here? Yeah, so you got like you obviously got the monarch, you got dukes, marquess, earls, viscounts, barons, and baronets. Okay, so barons are lowest of the ranks. But this is the actual, like, there's a huge list of how all these ranks go down here. And you've got the sovereign, so the king or queen, and you've got the Prince of Wales, which would be next in line to the throne. So on and so forth, all the way down. Now, when we go all the way down this list, there's something that we want to do. The judges of the High Court. Okay, so judges of the High Court are actually a title. Title, because it stems from the fountain of justice, which is the Queen. But that's the same is said for the titles. The titles are all from, let's say, the peers. Are all titles granted by the Queen's ability to be the monarch, really. So it's just like, it's like a piece, if you like. It's a little piece of the waterfall that flows all the way down, and you get barons and baronets, and you get the sirs, the knights. Now, unfortunately, I can't find the list that I had in my law book, because it's tricky. It's the pages are unnumbered, and I can't remember where I saw it. I've been looking for it for ages, but I have to give up. But then you've got like county court judges, and you've got sergeants in law. As far as I'm aware, sergeants in law is an old name for barristers, sergeants at law. I think that's where barristers come from. You had to be a sergeant in order to have rights of audience. These are the old terms for rights of audience in courts. And sergeants at laws eventually turned into barristers, if I remember correctly. Then we're going down here, you've got more and more and more and more. Now, the one thing that they miss off all of these lists that I've been looking at is that down the bottom here, so you've got gentlemen. Well, it's not actually on the list, but when you get down past knights, you then get to things like doctors. So doctors are still a rank of nobility. And then below doctors, you have things like gentlemen, which is here. I don't know if that's on its own. Gentlemen, and you also have merchants. So all these things are part of the scale that leads up to the Queen. But very seldom have I seen it listed that it goes like yeoman. I think even yeoman was on there. Yeoman's quite low down as well. So all of these things are titled and put in the pecking order. So I can only presume like a squire is obviously down there as well, and potentially a mister. I mean, I have no idea what a mister. I haven't really looked into it too much, but mister wasn't on the list. But presumably that falls into the esquire category. So right down the pecking order, you've got all these minute titles, or diminutive titles. But essentially, you know, if you're a baron and you've been promoted to an earl, so you've leapfrogged a viscount. So you're a baron, you've leapfrogged viscount and gone to earl. You're like, yeah, these are just part of the riffraff. Now, if this is part of the riffraff, obviously in jest he said that. But imagine where you stand. If you're all the way down here as part of their society and you're like going to be a squire or gentleman or a mister or a, you know, some sort of tradesman or something, not a trade, a merchant. You know, you're right down the pecking order. You have a very little privileges, should we say, if you're in the lower side of the scale, especially as you think of how he's gone to Earl, and he's taken the Mickey out of barons in a jestful way. Now let's go back. I hope it's this one. Let me just check my timer. Yeah, that's it. We've got up to 7 minutes now. So we're going to go straight up to seven. And this is Lord Cranbourne. Right, now Lord Cranbourne, in light of the threat to the hereditary peers, he's made a deal with Tony Blair. It seems like directly from what you tell here. So he's gone into the back, he's had a private meeting with Tony Blair and said, look, I'll help you kick out all these lords in a peaceful, polite way if you let a core amount, which is 92, how they came to that figure, who knows. But anyway, 92 of us stay, 92 of us hereditary stay, and we'll do it by some sort of, I think it's going to be done by some sort of election. So you put yourself up for election and the other guys will vote who remains.
The leader of the Conservatives at the time, Lord Cranbourne, had secretly offered Blair a deal. He promised they'd go quietly if a nucleus of the hereditary peerage could stay on until a decision were made as to how to replace them. And so out of a hereditary peerage of some 750, created by history, chance and birthright, 92 were to be allowed to stay for the time being. Each political party has to select 10% of its members, and they're to be chosen by election.
So there we go. 9:43. So they're going to have a little chat now.
This office to register for a CV.
Oh, this is him. This is him. Right, this is the guy. This is the guy who's liaised with Tony Blair, who wants to get rid of the House of Lords. So he's basically given a bargain and says, look, you scratch my back, I scratch yours. I'll kick these guys out if you let 92 stay on these terms. So they're going to arrange this election. So now she manages to nab him in the corridor, this journalist, and have a little chat with him, saying, right, well, tell us a bit more about that.
Words.
Very much indeed.
Is that all right?
That's brilliant.
There's nothing wrong with submitting yourself to election.
Nothing wrong with submitting yourself to election.
It's a perfectly honourable thing to do.
Perfectly honourable thing to do.
There's nothing in the least bit demeaning about that.
That's interesting.
Of course. Is it demeaning to submit yourself for election to the House of Commons? It's an honour. There's nothing demeaning about it.
See, he's putting a spin on it, isn't he? You know, instead of fighting it, instead of keeping all of his hereditary buddies in, you know, instead of actually digging your heels in and saying no, as the barons would have done many hundreds of years ago. I mean, these are all the people with the arms and the swords. These are the military might of the nation. And this is what we got now, is that we'll plead the deal out with Tony Blair in order to kick most of my fellows out of the house which they should be sitting in.
I've delicately put this in. Good morning.
So this guy here is put on his, like, election ballot. Why should you, you know, 75 words or less, you put down something to explain why they should vote for you. And I don't know if you can make it out on that piece of paper, but he's just literally put duty. It's my duty to do this. You see? It's simple word. He has a duty to be here and scrutinise legislature and what the government's up to in order to, for the better running of the realm. Yeah, that's a good, surprises everyone a bit, but that's a good one. So 8:35. We're going up to 9:43 now. Let's go to 9:43. Oh, this is lovely. Look at this piece of work. So this is a Tony Blair appointed minister who's now going to talk about the problems of having an unelected chamber.
And we can best judge it if we recognise the almost exquisite simplicity of what it proposes. It removes the right presently enjoyed by some 750 people, almost 100 more than the total elected to this House, to sit and vote in our Parliament solely on the basis of their birth and without any consideration whatever of their personal qualities or achievements.
So they're actually attacking their personal qualities and achievements there. Like I said, a lot of these boys and girls have been to, like, the best schools that in the land. A lot of them go to Eton and Oxford and Cambridge and other places. I'd be surprised if many of them send their kids to state school, but you know, maybe they do. Maybe there's a bit of a mixed bag of a children. Or maybe they only send their eldest to like Eton. Maybe they can only afford that. But you know, presumably they have more resources than the average Joe. But she's criticising that what have they actually done in their life, and what are they actually what are their actual qualifications like? So she's attacking the fact that they have, it's not a meritocracy, this is just a hereditary acquisition of a seat in the House to govern the legislature of these people, the Green seat people, the Commons. Now bear in mind that many, many, many political classes, something Nigel Farage always complains about, is that a lot of these people, you can go to college, you can go to university, you study politics, and then you go into some sort of political parties like secretarial role, and then eventually you'll get put forward as a member of parliament. I think is it Ed Miliband, and you know, David, I don't know if David Cameron was such a person, but essentially, you know, you never really go out into the real world and see and have a real career as such. You'll go from university into some sort of position of administration within the party or the House of Commons. And then eventually you'll get put into some sort of position where you can get elected for a particular role in a party. So it's not like this is like political classes, as it's sometimes referred to. So you don't actually have people of business of necessary acumen. You know, what achievement have you made in your life if you've gone to university and got a degree in politics? You know, and now you're sitting in it. Now you're supposed to know the entire history that created the Houses of Parliament. These are the things that the House of Lords would know, which is why people like Jacob Rees-Mogg are absolutely ripping up the House of Commons, because in my mind, Jacob Rees-Mogg has the kind of intellectual prowess and know-how, particularly the know-how, the history, the law, and how Parliament is supposed to function. And then when he stands up and addresses Parliament, he knows exactly, with full confidence, what he's saying in the context of Parliament. And of course, the biggest thing of all is that the people are whom the Parliament is supposed to serve. And that's why a lot of these career politicians and ex-Blairites and people who are there for a career kind of start getting egg on their face, because they forgot, or they're being led down a path that is not with those core beliefs of serving the people, serving Her Majesty's people. So, yeah, it's good. It's good to see. But anyway, so here we are. So she's criticising people without any kind of reason to, in my opinion.
Of course, some members opposite have started to say that they don't mind the House of Lords being replaced as long as it's with something better. Anything would be better.
So it's an absolute piss-take statement saying anything would be better than what we've got at the moment. 11:18. Let's crack on, and then I'll end it, and we'll go on to part two. Let's go here. Oh, this guy is an absolute trooper.
Decision.
Absolutely. I think it's still about standing for election or not.
Yeah.
So he's thinking about putting himself forward for an election to remain as one of the 92 that stay in the House of Lords. So he's obviously being pulled. You know, he knows he's not going to get it, but he knows he should put his name in the hat just in case he does get it, but he knows he won't get it. So they're all those 750 lords and hereditaries are going through this like, oh God. And they've got to like vote on their friends. They've got to leave some people out. And they're like, oh God, well, this is just a big mess, which is, what's his name? Lord Cranbourne has, this is the system. Lord Cranbourne has gone directly to Tony Blair to kind of initiate this system. And this guy's giving a very, very honest review about what he thinks.
Absolutely. I think it's still about standing for election or not.
Yeah. It's very difficult. If you're thoroughly conceited, like I am, to think that anybody would want one. I mean, look at me. I'm 77, practically, one foot in the grave. I'm not a politician. And there we are.
So whatever happens, you are an elector.
Yeah.
And then if you want to, you can just add to it and become a candidate as well.
God, it is a dilemma, isn't it?
It's terrifying, actually, I think, because I'm convinced it's tone for president. I'm convinced he wants to be president. Oh, my ancestor would be turning in the grave.
And that's the crucial thing. All the way through, I think his title was made in 1600-something. So for 400 years, his ancestors have had a right to sit in the House of Lords. And now he's in a position where he has to give over, submit, if you like, to the powers that be, and all of his 400 years worth of ancestors would be screaming at him. And this is something that this this program does kind of try to highlight, is that all the way back through history of our nation, is all these people, whether you like them or loathe them, who cares? But it's, at the end of the day, from their point of view, they're being asked to leave or vacate a house that they have by right, every right to be in. And that's what he's saying. My ancestors will be turning in my grave, because it's just that, like, the bottle has stopped on him, whatever has just happened. The buck, there we are, the buck has stopped with him. And he's the noble in the position where he has to decide, are you going to stand and fight for your right to be in the House of Lords? Or are you going to do what everyone else does and just give over and get kicked out of your own house? And I can't believe that they all got kicked out of their own house. And unfortunately, it's a black mark, if you like, a stain, a smirch, if that's the right word, on all of their honours, if you like. Because when they were push came to shove, they all got out of the way. They fell like dominoes. And even when one of their own kind makes private deals with Tony Blair to keep some of them in power, that's what he did. They just roll over and took it, which is a bit of disappointing. And in my later shows, I'm going to stop it there because it's quite a long one. But in my later shows, you'll see. You'll see what actually starts to transpire in relation to these guys.
Patient.
And we're also going to go into an Australian look at it, because it's always good to go to a more. And the fringes. It's like what I did with the Japanese constitution. Like, when you're trying to instate a Western cultural method of law, which has been hard fought over all the centuries, and then you defeat a foreign nation, try and impose your constitution, it's always, they have to explain it in much more simple terms and go through it in a much more detail so that they can clearly understand what that constitution means now for a nation, i.e. women's rights. Japan had no such thing. Women's right to vote, women's right to work. All these things came into Japan. It's like, holy, we've been defeated, and yet we've got these lovely new rights if you're a woman, and then how the government acts and all that. So it's and how you can, habeas corpus and all these other things that come into the constitution that Japan probably never had any kind of knowledge of. It's like, what do you mean? People have the right not to be held in prison indefinitely? Yeah, things like this. So it's nice to go to Australia and see how Australian, simplify it, look at it from an Australian perspective, like these stuffy old lords. They really lay into the stuffy old lords. And they concentrate on Lord Bath, of all people, which is probably the worst of all to focus on, because he's quite an eccentric, if you like. So if you focus on the extreme, you don't really get a baseline of the norm. But we're going to look at that as well later. But this is all to come. So I'll end the video here, and we'll go through it in a much more detail in our continuing parts. And hopefully this will be a nice way to break down how Parliament was and has changed and what that means now for our constitution in the UK. And, of course, if you're American, it's worth knowing where all the principles of your forefathers, they left all this behind and they copied it in a certain respect. So it's nice just to have a good grounding about how the... The triangle works in terms of checks and balances, why you have a executive, why you have a Congress, and why you have a Senate. Anyway, I'll leave it there. Ciao, Bella.